Hello guys, and welcome to 100 Days in ASMRcraft. I am super excited to bring this video to you guys. Been working on it for well over a couple of months now, and it is finally ready for you guys to enjoy. So please, sit back, relax, put some headphones on, and enjoy.
Associated with the 100 days.
yeah, we were probably about 400 or 500 blocks away from that desert warp. So we'd made a good journey out. And yeah, I decided to just sort of settle down here by the river on the edge of a jungle biome, and on the other side a sort of savanna where there are plenty of acacia trees. So I thought it'd be quite a nice exotic location for a starter base, which is not usually that common. I headed back after setting a home to Mystical Dragon, the city where I was gifted some wool very, very generously, so I could have a bed of my own, and I continued clearing out a lot of the area. Just getting rid of some of the trees and whatnot, and I then decided to make my first foray into the shopping district, Harvey's Mega, Mega Shop, or I don't know if you call it Superstore. From buying and selling the odd bits and pieces, I definitely had enough money to get at least a couple of stacks of iron, which I did. So I started making a bridge, and I have to say, I think the thing that I enjoyed the most was how quickly I could kind of get set up with the use of the shopping district. These huge iron farms that people have set up have obviously brought the general price of iron way, way, way down, and generally means that you can get full iron without really trying too hard at all, which is good. Also meant I could get full iron tools, and us being quite cautious with things as we moved into day 5. But I think in retrospect, I probably could have just sunk all of my money into iron. Although I guess it maybe was a good idea not to use all of it, as I soon found out I would need to spend a fair amount of my money on claim blocks. But we took the things that we had gathered and we went and sold a bunch of it in the admin shops just to get a bit of extra money. The main reason for this was to get money for some more claim blocks. I think we might have been offered some money by people. I can't quite remember, but we gathered about $800, as you can see there, and that was enough to buy a few more claim blocks, and I was happily able to expand our claim to a reasonable size, at least. I think one thing that, as a server owner, I would want to go back and maybe alter slightly is maybe they should be cheaper. Maybe they should be accumulated quicker through sort of passive action or something. Because I felt maybe I was sort of gathering and selling a bit too much. I wouldn't say I was frustrated by the process, but it slowed down my starter base situation. Maybe I'm thinking a bit too deeply into it, I'm not sure. Maybe you guys can let me know what you think about that. But day 7 was more gathering. We'd accumulated a large number of saplings, and I decided to plant them in a huge kind of oak block. And something that you'll probably notice if you watch through the entirety of this video is that I do a lot of planting and wood chopping. I find it quite relaxing, but also it was entirely necessary for money making. Wood was, at this point in the game at least, a very, very, very lucrative business. Logs were selling for quite a lot of money in the admin shops, but we changed our system economy-wise as a staffing team, which sort of scuppered that plan a little bit, but it's not really within, I would say, the entire scope of this video, really. This is more about, the whole survival aspect of playing, so I'll save that for another video, I think. But yeah, more wood chopping, birch, oak, jungle wood, acacia wood, you name it. If it had log at the end of it, we were chopping it down, and I sort of kept this on the side of my starter base for a while, but I eventually expanded out to the other side of the river, like I had with the oak logs. And I would say the majority of this was, I would say 90% of it was to make money, to eventually sell in the admin shops. Going strong into day 8, cutting down birch trees and jungle trees mostly, the sort of trees that are quite easy to accumulate. I think retrospectively I would have gone back and maybe just got some spruce saplings from somebody and focused on that, but I decided to sort of expand things in towards the end of day 8, moving into day 9, by starting some of my favourite simple build types that I always think just look kind of neat, which is, as the Americans might say, which is just making some big floating wheat river islands. I don't know why I like them, I just do. And I set up one to begin with, but as I gained more seeds, I expanded that to quite a few of these little wheat islands. And no, I don't regret it. It's probably a bit of a waste of time. Something I've always struggled with, like being able to repeat easily, is making farms. I just haven't got a redstone brain. I don't know how to describe it. I could have easily have made some sort of automatic wheat farm or something. In fact, I think I do eventually go and buy some redstone to do that, but it's never been something I've easily come to. I decided to set up a shop just to generate a bit of additional money, maybe passive income when I wasn't online. I thought setting up some wood shops would make sense, given how much I was cutting it down, and given it's manual labour, and it's quite hard to make. At least, as far as I'm aware, it's quite difficult to make like tree farms, automatic ones, I mean. I set up a jungle birch oak log shop and put some random prices, which, as far as I remember, were fairly successful at making me that decent passive income. Obviously, they're going to be higher price than the admin shops, and I was quite happy with the way it sort of turned out. I didn't do anything fancy for the shop, it just sort of existed there. But that's really all I did in day 9. Moving into the sort of latter part of day 9, I decided to start a mine. The rhyme is not intentional there. I was trying to think of a different way of saying that, so I didn't have to do a weird rhyme. But there we go. I started digging into the earth to make a little spot where the mine would exist, and that was mostly because I felt I needed to. I think you need a mine, don't you? Let's be honest. Kept chopping down the trees as we moved into day 10, and the mine was there mostly to give me some wood. Some wood makes no sense at all. To give me some stone and things like that, cobblestone. One of the things that I realised later on, a good moneymaker, were the, like, I don't know how you describe them, the mineral stone types, granite, andesite, and diorite. Not from a shop perspective, think that's just a byproduct of the server type, I suppose. It's quite easy to attain things like stone and the things you would generally mine for in early games. So as you can see, coal, copper, and iron. Iron especially is such an easily farmable item that I guess I could have farmed it myself, but I never would, and so I would have found myself in the mine. But in this case, because it's so easily farmable, and because there are so many people who are willing to farm it, it's sold at such a crazily cheap price that it just made sense to mine, chop down a few trees, get the money for the iron, at least from my perspective, and the amount of effort it would take for me to make an automatic iron farm. It made sense for me just to do this, get the money, and then basically give it to other people for their iron. So yeah, that's what I continued to do, and day 12, as you can see, was more of the same. To be honest, the more I was chopping down trees, the worse the problem became, because I had more saplings, and so my lizard brain basically just said, plant the saplings, get more wood. More wood equal money. And I found it, as I said, it's quite, I wouldn't say cathartic, that might be a little bit too far, but it's certainly an enjoyable process, one you can just turn your mind off from doing. And I would sit there playing for, several hours, just chopping down tree after tree after tree. Decided to expand my farming empire, moving slowly into day 13 by including sugarcane alongside my wood chopping and my bamboo empire, which eventually, I wouldn't say an empire, because obviously, again, as you can imagine from what I said before, I'm not much of a farm guy. I quite like doing things manually. I think actually that sort of suits the ASMR nature of things more. Obviously, if you guys would like me to dabble with redstone and farms, then let me know. Perhaps that would be quite an interesting change of pace on the channel. I'm not sure. You guys decide. You be the judge. But we continued putting down copper as the night was starting to fall. At this point, oxidized copper wasn't something you could sell. In fact, it actually still isn't, but I do plan on adding that. Day 13. What do you reckon I was doing? Of course, planting saplings and cutting down trees, although I decided to at least add a couple of storage containers so that I could at least keep track of how much wonderful logs I had been obtaining. And I decided to sort of at least make some use of my time by clearing out some of the jungle, those small little jungle trees you can find. So at least we were gaining a larger clearing, and I think mostly the reason for that was more space to put down copper blocks, but alas, space nonetheless. As you can see what I'm doing right now, I assumed you probably know what I was doing at this point. I'm putting down another wheat floating platform, because why not? We've got more seeds, we've got more wheat, why not expand the wheat, bamboo, and eventually hopefully sugarcane. And I don't want to spoil things for you guys, but eventually, and I keep this to yourselves, don't go ruining it in the comment section, but I'd eventually add cactuses to my empire. And as you can see, the more birch trees I'm chopping down, the I went to the Harvey's Megastore, of course, and I bought a whole bunch of diamonds. You know, that's the way to go about it. Once you've got to iron, why not expand to diamond? And once I'd got diamond, I mean, this is one thing that I really enjoy about this server, is that because of the community trading aspect of it, you can really focus on whatever you want to do. Earning a bit of money isn't difficult at all, and without even really needing to mess around with anything, by the time we were making our way into day 16, we already had basically all diamond tools. And had I set up maybe a couple of simple farms at the start of day 1 or whatever, I'd probably be in full enchanted diamond gear at this point. To be quite honest, if I'd taken the offer to move to Mystical Dragon City, I probably would be even better off, but I decided to stick it out alone, and despite that, and despite my complete inefficiencies of no farm use or anything, day 16, I've got diamond tools without even finding any diamonds, so I think that's quite interesting. I decided to start, and it's actually at this point that I realised I had a bit of a pattern going on here with my farms. I decided to do a kind of weird pattern to things. The reason being, I don't know, I just thought it looked kind of cool, and so I made them all sort of jaggedy. I mean, this is really the level of building quality we're dealing with here. And that's what I went with. That is pretty much what I went with for these wheat farms. I think we might have added another one just onto the side here, just to sort of make it nice and uniform and fill out the river a little bit. But we continue to expand our wheat, and to be honest, aside from the odd hay bale sale, and I guess the usefulness of wheat for breeding animals, and I suppose making bread if you're particularly short or something, I did it mostly for the aesthetics. I like the look of wheat. Day 17, it was pissing it down all day, so I decided that now would be a good time as any, really, to set up some lanterns. No idea why I decided to use probably the ugliest wood type for this particular use. I decided to make acacia fences for this job. I don't know why, they don't really go, but I did it, and so at this point you're just going to have to deal with it, because we're ploughing on, no pun intended, but as we plough on to day 100, there's no stopping now, and the acacia, those acacia, whatchamacallits, fences are here to stay. So you can make your complaints, and hopefully if you do, I can adjust some things. And I don't just mean this for the fences, but if you want something in particular in the series, or you want me to build something, feel free to make your recommendations. I don't promise anything, but they will, if I do add something, it will be in the 200 days episode, which God knows when that's gonna come out. So, but yeah, so we continue to expand this little wheat thing. As I said, mostly for aesthetics. At this point, it's sort of an unnecessary amount of wheat field. If I really wanted this much wheat, even I probably would have committed to making a sort of vaguely automatic system. But no, I just thought it kind of added a bit to the area and whatever. So that's really the entire reason I did it. And I do think they look kind of cool. Yeah, I like them. And I don't know if really they do a job, but I think they make sense in the area. One thing that I will hope to focus on in day 200, not wanting to give too much away about improve my building skills. It's always been something I felt I've lacked in Minecraft. I'm relatively good at making simple environmental things, so I make a good path. I think I make a good path, at least. I make a good field. I do a decent amount of passable, what would you call it? Like terraforming, that's the word I'm looking for. I do good terraforming. But that's really about it. My actual building skills, you know, off my own back, they leave a lot to be desired. But yeah, hopefully I can make some improvements in that and use this series to improve my building skills. Day 19, I decided to start sort of clearing out the sort of uneven ridge of this mountain, which once I'm done with this, it might seem like a sort of fruitless task, but later on in 100 days, you will see that there is quite a good use for this area, which, yeah, I'm not going to give away just now. But for now, I sort of block up the area and just leave it a little bit tidier, because it did have a big dirt overhang to it. Stone walls around his base in season 2. I thought it looked really, really will see in a second something very, very amazing happens. There you go. I asked the server, what is a lot of money? And as it gave me $100,000, which is a big amount of money at the start of the game. Some people have millions and millions of dollars. I think the current highest amount is like 7 million, and I think that's sort of where it capped out this season. But $100,000 is enough to completely change the approach of a new player, I would say, sort of regardless of when in the season it is. $100,000 allowed me to change my my approach to how I was going to do things. I was going to slowly accumulate money bit by bit and gain some enchantments maybe from the Ender farm when I eventually got there. I'm not even sure if it's built at this point, but the Enderman farm would be where I'd get XP. I'd then get some more diamonds, I'd buy some obsidian, I'd do my own enchanting, because heaven knows I wouldn't be doing a villager farm myself or a villager breeder. As I sort of ramble on day 22, we're continuing the wall around our massive, just the entirety of our starter base, which was kind of growing day by day. As you can see there, it is starting to look quite nice, but I did eventually decide to head to the shopping district to take that $100,000 we had been graciously gifted and just start buying out a bunch of enchanted books. I'd say the average price for an enchanted book of really any kind at this point was about, as you can see, $1,000 each. So if we particularly wanted to, we could have bought 100 enchanted books, which is enough really to enchant absolutely everything. On the getting towards the end of day 22, we went to the PvP arena where we were watching one of the rounds of the PvP fight. It was Kira versus Squiddy, which, as you can see, Squiddy lost. Kira won, and that was it for day 22, and an interesting addition to the end of our day. And eventually on day 23 we went back to buying a whole bunch of enchanted books, all the useful ones: Unbreaking, Fortune, Looting, Mending books of course were the ones that I was really up for, but we got through all the cheap ones, and eventually I had to sort of expand out to the slightly more expensive ones. I just basically, wherever I could find someone selling these enchanted books, I would buy from them. Data Mega was a really good store. They sold a whole bunch of them, and I'd like to go to Harvey's Mega Store and continue my lazy buying of items I could probably have found myself, but there we go. Exploring the shopping district was pretty fun though, I have to say. As you can see, I really took the opportunity to enjoy exploring the shopping district in full, I think, or at least in as much as I could, really for the first time. This was, in my opinion, a really good opportunity to do so. Advantage of my newfound riches to go around and really take myself to the next level in terms of my gear and whatnot. As you can see, I just had a whole host of enchanted books, diamonds, and of course my brand new beacon, which I was very, very, very happy. Was to finally get the Cover Me with Diamonds advancement and get myself out entirely. I think the only negative to this is, well, I would say that it's an unrealistic way using the surrounding space mostly, rather than where I'd sort of set up my initial starter area with the furnace and a couple of chests and things like that. So that's why I decided to go to this position after buying out all of Harvey's iron. I moved on to his gold storages, and that's when I continued with that. I certainly had enough money for it, and whatever. And I guess, I mean, I don't know if Acid personally is going to be watching this, but this almost certainly is not the most cost-effective way to use your money.
Awesome. It's gonna stay.
enchanting items, but I still do quite like that process. So you'll see that whilst I also use the books that I just spent a lot of money on, I do also do a bit of my own enchanting, and that's why, unsurprisingly, I was starting to stock up on all of the relevant items I would need to make a full enchanting area. Unfortunately, this time RV was clean out of stock. I managed to buy a bit of sugarcane, which would at least get me to the amount I would need of paper without having to make too much of it myself, so I thank Emma for that, from her natural shop. And it was after a bit of discussion with Truckstan, the chap in front of me, that I negotiated a bit of a leather restock in his area. He took a little while to come through on that, and he would eventually restock even more, as you'll see, moving into day 29 and 30, but it was enough to get me most of the way, and in all honesty, it probably motivated me later on to get a bit of a cow farm going, which I suppose is the absolute minimum you can expect from somebody. Moving into day 29, the storage area was on my mind. As you can see, I was clearing out a little bit, and we'll come on to that in quite a bit, but I decided to invest a couple of K in some shock boxes, as you saw me purchase from Crypto Nerg's area, or his shop, and I decided that I would want a nice selection of colours for my shocker boxes. From memory, I don't think I have actually associated any of these colours with anything in particular, which is not like me. Usually I'll make a brown shocker box for wood, a grey shulker box for stone, maybe a cyan or light blue shulker box for my diamond items and things, and a red shulker box for fireworks, but I don't think I actually identified them in such a way this time, which now I'm going to be watching back this playthrough, I think it's going to be a little frustrating to me, because that's always something I really like doing, or at least really value doing, and I don't think I actually gave much thought to it at all at the time, but it's probably why I spent a lot of time sifting or filtering through my shulker boxes, not knowing what's in what. I'd even usually name them, if I'm remembering that correctly. But in day 30, I decided to finally restock my I'd used most of my money already by this point on enchantments and diamonds and iron and gold and other accoutrements. And so I didn't quite have the money to splash out, you know, 10 bars of netherite. I don't think I was even really near to being able to buy 2 or 3. I think I might. Several projects. I say several projects, I mean one main project. guess at this stage isn't, you know, vitally important to get. It might have been more important if I was searching for diamonds and such, but it was still good to have, and I would eventually use that to get all the sorts of items I would need, you know, including diamonds, because whilst I could theoretically buy those somewhat on the cheap, it still made sense to go and collect them myself. But anyway, day 37, back to the surface and back to chopping down birch before heading back into the mines. Chopping, mining copper was quite important. I felt that I would be able to make decent money from that, oxidizing them and then selling them. This never really materialized as such, but as a general practice, I think it's something I'll continue with into any series in season 4. Oxidizing the copper is a long process, and one that I guess if you're making much quicker and more consistent money from it through iron and things, it doesn't really make sense to oxidize the copper. So I felt it would be at least just a smart idea to grab it where I found it, smelt it up, and then oxidize it and sell the oxidized copper in a shop. Like I said, this never really happened, but it was something that I kind of kept up as a sort of daily chore throughout the 100 days. I would collect my smelted copper ingots, turn them into blocks, place the blocks down in a neat pattern of sorts, and collect them when I saw that they'd oxidized, and it's something that took a quick second, and I thought would eventually yield some sort of value, and I think it would have yielded good value had I sort of stuck to the idea of eventually selling them in my shop, should there have been maintained high activity on the server. But alas, that's maybe one for the next series, I suppose. But as you can see, continuing with that idea, towards the end of day 38, and I was sort of running out of room to place all of my copper, but I suppose that just shows you how rich I was becoming with all of my copper. Once you get Fortune 3 on your pickaxe, the amount of copper you're obtaining is kind of ridiculous. But to me, it still kind of made sense, because I was thinking those people that would spend good money on buying oxidized, apparently I'm a scientist, oxidized copper blocks would likely be the people who don't go mining, and so would be unlikely to spend time bothering oxidizing their own copper, or mining the copper and oxidizing it. And so that was my thinking, at least. Like I said, sort of fruitless process in the end. Logically, I thought was a sensible one. Funnily enough, one of the other good things about this cavern, although I'm not really sure it's limited to the cavern, you could certainly get the exact same results from strip mining at this level, but deep slate, hugely valuable. Again, another, I guess, non-renewable resource which could only be obtained through grinding mining. As you can see, just before day 40, I ran away like a scaredy cat from a horde of zombies and other undead before heading back down with my tail between my legs. But yeah, it's something that you need to collect to be able to sell, so, or be able to use, should I say. So that's why I was mining a fair amount of deep slate. And of course, mining up the diamonds wherever I should find them. find diamonds on the surface, it feels far, far more likely that you'll find a single vein, you know, a solo diamond vein. Is that actually true, or have I just gotten unlucky? I say this and then I show a bunch of surface level diamonds that weren't solo, so perhaps it was just kind of my mind playing tricks on me, or just sort of recency bias or something like that. Is that am I using that phrase correctly? I'm not sure. But anyway, day 14, we've now spent, or moving into day 41, we had spent a significant amount of time in the mines, a good near enough 7 or 8 days down in the mines, and by the time I'd come out, it was time to actually repair my items for the first time in 100 days. I'd put mending and everything on them around day 30 or so, and so gave me a good idea of, you know, solid use of my items, how long it would take before I needed to mend them. And I was happy with this rate. However, that got me thinking about mending and unbreaking, and it wasn't too long after day 40, I think maybe day 50 or so, that myself, obviously as medic rather than Dr. Flaff, that we started doing giveaways and ideas for prizes in events that would be sort of vanilla plus things, so Unbreaking 4, Mending 2, which I don't think we actually ever gave away, but it was an idea. Mending 2 to me seems almost a little bit pointless, because mending is already so quick in mending your items, so I suppose you'd have to be quite well off with the vanilla plus things to vie for a vanilla MA Mending 2 item. But it got me thinking about it, and I was thinking how cool it would be in the next season if we really started pushing on Vanilla Plus, maybe a little bit earlier. As you can see now, day 42, I'm finally going for my personal favourite enchantment, the one that I think is, you know, ironically, I'm going for it last. I personally think it's the most important. It's certainly my favourite enchantment, which is Feather Falling 4. If I was given, you know, one option for a enchantment on my items, only one on one item, it would be Feather Falling on boots, of course. Although, you know, if I think about it, maybe mending would be more cost effective or something like that, but Feather Falling, knowing my clumsiness, is maybe slightly more important. Day 43, it's more experience gaining and leveling up at the end of farm. If I haven't already credited it, I think Harvey made this as well, and aside from being such an important source of experience and leveling for the entire community, I really can't overstate how important these end farms are. It's also a nice little addition of money. I'd say every trip that I make here, I make an extra 1,000 or so by selling the inventory of end pearls that I keep. So that's always relatively nice. Day 43 to day 44, you saw, at this point there were always quite a lot of new players joining, but it's quite rare that you catch it in the chat, and a guy called Chicken Master joined, and then shortly after, as you can see, I do a little speed up as I allow a whole bunch of Endermen to spawn and eventually kill them all and get myself 57 levels overall. myself into a position where I could do repeated enchantment after enchantment after enchantment and hopefully come away with a feather falling, you know, fall would be brilliant. But, you know, I take really anything, and as you can see, I just got astronomically unlucky with the enchantments. As far as I am aware, you can get feather falling 3 or 4, as I can add it on enchantment sort of randomly. You know, if it says unbreak 3, you could end up with feather falling on them, which is what I was kind of hoping for, but nope, I got pretty unlucky. And so that's why I decided to go back into the mines to try and find some more diamonds to eventually convert into more diamond boots. I suppose you could quite sensibly suggest that I should have used a grindstone on them. Now I'm going to share with you, as we move into day 46, I'm going to share with you the sort of logical fallacies that I work with, or not really, I suppose logical fallacies isn't really a good use of the term, but more just the sort of inefficiencies that I work on in Minecraft, and I find it really hard to not do this. When I looked at that, I thought, okay, I could grindstone off all of those relatively useless enchantments. I've got 6, 7, 8 pairs of now almost redundant diamond boots. The very important thing to do at that point would be to get a grindstone and to grind off those useless enchantments. Instead, my thought process was, I don't know how to make a grindstone. Now, for anyone who values their time and wants to be efficient on Minecraft, the next logical step, I think, would be to Google the phrase "how to make a grindstone in Minecraft." But instead, no, this is what you might find quite infuriating. It's not that I didn't think about that. I certainly did think about that. I just decided against it, and instead thought this is a good opportunity to go and mine more diamonds. But that does not make sense, because I'm just going to turn them into more boots anyway. So, this entire process, covering days, now on day 48, was pointless. And I think for me, if I really looked into my psyche and tried to understand, why, medic, why are you doing this? I think the answer is just that I like mining. I like the relative monotony of it. I like the lack of thought that comes into it. And to be honest, I think that is just a great explanation of why I like Minecraft. If you can't be bothered to think about building something, if you can't be bothered to be creative, you can just go mining. You can set a task of yourself, like me, mining diamond to make boots. You can go and do it. Now, thankfully, I actually got quite lucky with diamonds. As you saw, we got a number of high efficient system by which I can achieve a Minecraft task. Now, I know that's very technical speak, but hopefully if you Google some of those terms that I use, you'll understand what I was making. Basically, what it does is you can very quickly, or I guess AFK in a way, you can smelt items up and it'll put it in a chest for you. Now, I know I'm getting a bit technical, but that's what it does. At day 50, we're planting down a huge mesh of oak. I decided to sell my cobble deep slate to the admin shops, which I think very quickly I will reflect on as being an astonishingly bad idea, because people were willing to pay way above the odds, you know, 4 or 5 times that per stack if I was to sell them directly to people. But nope, I decided to sell it to the admin shop and wasted an absolutely an astonishing amount of money. I decided that it might be quite a good idea to sell my redstone as well. Looking back on that, maybe also a fairly poor idea, as I think I actually ended up going to Harvey's shop and buying redstone from him, which was just a very silly process that I went through. Although I think that one a little bit later. This whole process though of kind of getting stuff and selling stuff and getting stuff and selling stuff was all to do this. As you saw a little bit on day 49 and at the start of day 50 and now at the end of day 50, I wanted to greatly expand my area. And as we fly up into the air and take an aerial view, I now have a lovely expanse, a huge rectangular area on day 51. And I decided to keep buying and keep expanding my domain at this sort of range, this sort of, you know, X by Y size area, even expanding by just a couple of blocks, cost thousands of dollars. Obviously, of course, you're working in a two-dimensional space, so everything is sort of squared in the pricing, if that makes sense. Does that make sense? I think it does. Is that, if you graph that, would that be exponential in a way? I think it would. A squared exponential. As you can probably understand, I have no idea what I'm talking about, but I hope that kind of makes sense. Day 52. More Enderman killing, more leveling, as I have a bunch of things that I wanted to enchant. I thought, I've got all these diamonds, I may as well use them and enchant them. Like I said, reflecting back on sort of 10-15 days previous to this, I find myself, once I get to that enchantment point in a save in a game, whatever, I get in this cycle of enchanting. As you can see, I just like having lots of enchanted items. Lots of enchanted items. I'm not really sure why. Day 52, a bit of AFK, and then day 53, tons and tons and tons of Enderman killing. I hope this part of the video doesn't make you sick, but that's what I was doing. And I got myself to and from, up to a decent level. I think Harvey was actually AFKing at that point, wanting to level himself up, but I sort of scuppered his plans there, maybe just a little bit. And continuing into day 53, it was a whole lot more of enchanting. I decided that I wanted the feather falling, and so after purchasing a feather falling book, in fact I think it might have even been gifted to me storage room. This is going to be one of the most beautiful and huge storage rooms you've ever seen. So I rounded up two cows, put them in a little pen, and I started the process of slowly but surely breeding them up. I found another one which, after breeding the first pair, gave me four cows, and we were away. It was a simple little pen. I extended out some of the dirt underneath it and placed some chests down that I would eventually house a bunch of my wheat that I was growing on those little wheat fields in the ocean or in the lake, I suppose, or river. Actually, more accurately. And I would think I'm going to put some seeds in there as well, but it's basically just there to help breed up the cows. The end, or I guess back end of day 56 was a bit more chopping down, and this was less for resource gathering and more to clear out a bit of space at first. Although as much as I really do in Minecraft, which is really rather limited, I decided that I'd clear out the space but then use the edge of this little kind of dirt plateau type thing. I'd use it to house a bunch of different trees, which I'm not sure we get to that in a day, within 100 days, but I eventually did types of trees. One thing I'm really looking forward to is the cherry blossom trees in 1.20, and I wonder if that is something you people are also looking forward to. Day 57, a continuation of my tree chopping chores. That is certainly a mouthful to say, tree chopping chores. Not sure it's very ASMR-y. Sound, the ch-ch-ch sound has never been an ASMR sound that I've particularly enjoyed, but let me know what you think about that. I'd like to do a bit more traditional ASMR in these videos. I think that would work quite well with the long style of 100 days. And then in the back end of day 57, I was clearing some time. see, we've moved into day 59. One thing I'm sure you're thinking is that this no doubt took a lot of jungle wood, and that it's finally making good use of the amount of time that I have spent and will still spend on chopping down jungle wood. We're in a good location for it, for sure. Between the big pillars, I made these single large pillars of jungle wood. At first I was thinking they might look a bit feeble for what they're meant to be doing. I'm talking physically speaking, you know, the actual physics of this building working. But then I decided I would build it and see how it looked, and if they needed to be increased in size or fleshed out in any way, then I could do that. And kind of just, yeah, we'll see how it goes. It's sort of against the general ethos of how I was building this in general, which is wanting to be a bit more careful with my planning, and this was more kind of just seeing how it looks and whatever. But I suppose it's got to be a bit of give and take. You can't completely plan out your build. I suppose you can. I suppose that is maybe, I guess, ideal. I'm not really sure, but obviously in the real world, you'd never start building something without it being, you know, worked out to the absolute minutiae for obvious reasons, whereas in Minecraft, I feel like, you know, it's okay just to be a bit take more creative liberty with things, or not even really creative liberty, but just sort of do things on a sort of random basis. I hadn't established a height for this, I just kept building them up until I reached the point that I'd set out with those single width framework. I think ideally it would be good to have it at like an odd number. I think that usually works out when you're building the walls around it and the windows and things, so that you have if you have even numbers, it can make it a little bit tricky. I'm not sure if that is always the case, but that's something that I've noticed when I've built things in the past. And I think I did map that out to be odd, but the height I did not, so we were just kind of doing that as, you know, again, just taking it kind of as it went. Day 61, cutting down more jungle wood, and that's a pattern you're going to watch over and over again for the next few days, I think. Day 62, again, we're going to be building up, but not before I visit the shopping district, and I can't remember what I was doing there. Oh, that was it. I was showing somebody my shop, which is quite funny. I remember thinking at the time, and I've thought that in the past, that it sort of defeats the point of the shops if you need, well, it doesn't really defeat the point, because I suppose they'll know where it is for the next time they need it, but it does make it a little bit, you know, time consuming to have to show people where your shop is. And obviously if you're not online, then they certainly wouldn't find it unless they were willing to spend a significant amount of time searching for your shop. And as I've mentioned previously and in other videos, that just scuppers trade quite significantly. So I started out putting in the floors after I'd set all the framework up, and I initially was going to go all birch, as you can see, and then thought, why don't I just try a bit of a kind of checkerboard pattern. I've never really messed around with a floor type like that, and I thought, well, I may as well give it a go, because it's one of those weird things. I've always seen, now I'm not particularly a good builder, but for some reason I maintain a sort of level of elitism when it comes to it, which makes absolutely no sense. I hope you find this lesson nauseating and more satisfying to watch. Please let me know what you think of this sort of thing. But I see checkerboard patterns all the time on floors, and I always think, oh, that's like such a just like basic way of doing it. Well, I don't scoff at it like how I didn't go. Oh. But in my head, I do think, oh, that's, you know, quite a basic way of doing things, even though it almost always looks good. And so I've never really done it before because I thought that other people might see it and go, oh, you know, you didn't put much thought into that. You just kind of did a checkerboard pattern or something. I'm making it sound as if I've put loads of thought into this and I'm really self-conscious about it. I'm really not. It's just, I guess, a vague reason why I've not done one before. And this time I thought,
this is a
lifetime world. It was ridiculous what I had in mind, and I was really determined to make it something memorable for myself, a build that wasn't just another build on another world, but one that I could really look back on fondly and think, oh yeah, that was cool what I made. That particular thing sticks in the memory. I think I do vaguely achieve that, but I suppose I'll let you guys be the judge. Day 68, the beams were, you know, pretty much getting towards being finished on the internal side of things. And with those beams put up, it would, as you can see, sort of like this part, this sort of middle beamage, that gave me a second floor, or I suppose in the UK, gave me a first floor, plus the ground floor. And that gave me a nice framework and would allow me to know where I could start putting my chests. And I was thinking, well, how could I do the walls between the beams? And then I had an idea that I wouldn't have walls per se, but instead the individual rooms or the individual sections of each floor of the storage facility would be split with the chests themselves. There are going to be so many chests, and they're going to be organized in such a way that that they would split themselves kind of naturally. So as you come in, you're in a bit of a foyer area. We'll do a bit of a tour later, but you're in a bit of a foyer area, and you are surrounded by lines and lines of chests, like shelves of books in a library. So as you can see, that's where you'll come through, and then each sort of stack or column of chests is a separator. I decided, while I was chopping down this big oak monstrosity, I decided I'd finally get rid of it. One of those things where you plant down all of your oak saplings, and then stone to block out what's inside of it. I wanted people to know. I wanted people to know that this building contained more chests than you've ever seen before. As sort of vaguely unimpressive as that maybe sounds, or at least sort of like a whoop-de-doo type thing, that was the gimmick of this. Well, it's not even a gimmick, it's very functional, but that was the whole point of this build. It was that it was stocked full, chock-a-block, from floor to ceiling, full of chests, and I wanted that to be conveyed from the outside, not just from the inside, so that's why I decided that glass at this point would be quite a good material to build the walls out of, but in time we'll come to that. At this point I'm just filling all the gaps in on the ground floor now. And I was kind of thinking, should I add some extra things like these gaps between the walls of chests? Maybe I could do something else, like in that space there. And I think, okay, it could be a cop out to just put more chests. It's almost like you can't think of more to put, which I guess in a sense maybe is somewhat true. But then I thought, no, the whole point is this place is meant to be absolutely full of chests. I want to never run out of chests. Something that from the very, very beginning of my Minecraft playing that I've always struggled with is when I'm designing a chest area or a storage area, is getting an accurate idea of how many chests or sort of size sections I need for different genres or types of Minecraft items, you know, natural items, food items, armor items or whatever, you know, combat items. I can never calculate it correctly and it ended up just becoming a frustrating process, which is sort of what inspired this. I wanted to just have so many chests that I would never need to worry about some crazy level of organization to things, because I just had so many that I would never run out, and so being a stickler for organization wouldn't even really be necessary in a way. But as we are creeping towards day 18, currently on day 77, it's the kind of final touches on the ground floor that are happening. I'm just going around showing myself and for you guys that there are no gaps, or at least unwanted gaps between things. I kept some sort of open files that would be the office, obviously the where you would walk around the place, and then I thought at this point it would be a good opportunity to just do a sort of flyby to show how many double chests there were. And as you can see, it's pretty crazy. Day 78 though, you'd think I'd be done with cutting down wood, but no. there's always a need for more, and I just get the process of chopping down and planting and then chopping down again the birch and the jungle wood. I initially wasn't too sure what I would use. First floor, I guess if you're American or anything other than British, you call it the second floor. And I don't even think I ever came to a proper conclusion on that. I just sort of, it was just an extra floor in the end. I guess essentially finishing the storage facility build. As I mentioned, I like the idea of glass floor-to-ceiling windows that would give people who visited the area a good view of what was inside. And so I thought at this point it'd probably be best for me to use the opportunity to make a super smelter type thing. And I say super smelter, but really what I mean is my own sort of cockeyed version of a super smelter. It's one of those things I absolutely do know how to make a super smelter. I could have taken an extra 10-20 minutes to make it properly, but alas, I organised in day 80 some of my items and got diorite, granite, andesite, that sort of stuff. Went and sold it to the admin shops before heading to the end farm and Enderman XP farm and getting a bunch of levels, or at least just fixing up some of my tools. I took a couple of shulker boxes, and the reason is because I just wanted to make one or at most two trips to the desert, and I started mining out an absolute crap ton of sand. This is a process I was quite familiar with from season 1. If you played season 1 of ASMRcraft, or if you watched any of my content of season 1 of ASMRcraft, you will know that I did a ridiculous amount of sand mining in that season, for a different reason though. The reason for the sand mining here was, as you can imagine, was to make a fair amount of glass. I thought an inventory full plus 3 shulker boxes would just about do it. I think I was right. I might have even slightly overestimated how much I needed, because I think I've still got quite a bit of glass left over. But that extended into day 82. In season 1 of ASMRcraft, the reason that I was frequenting the desert a lot to mine out and collect sand was because my main business in ASMRcraft was concrete. Concrete was my jam. I made a massive concrete shop, which the design for I am still pretty proud of. I don't think it actually turned out exactly how I had envisaged, but I was quite proud of how it, of what I came up with. So in the shopping district of season 1, I built a what looked like an upturned paint bucket that was pouring out this rainbow coloured paint. You know, the whole colour spectrum of the rainbow in, I think in wool and in concrete, whatever. And it's all splashed down into a big bucket type thing. And I think it looked quite cool. I definitely still have the videos on my channel, so you could have a look in the ASMRcraft Season 1 playlist if you're particularly interested. And then inside of there, there were three tiers, three floors, which was, it would have been like the darker colours, or should I say the, oh, there's a name, monotone colours, is that right? Monotone. Maybe that's wrong, I don't know. But white, grey, all the greys, different greys, black, and I think I might have included brown in that. I kind of see those as the sort of monotone colours. The next levels were more multicoloured. I was really happy with that. But obviously this time, the glass, the sand was for the glass. And in day 84, I started actually laying down all of that glass that I had smelted up in the smelter, which I had got going. So static prices in the shopping district and now dynamic prices in the shopping district. So yeah, day 86, I think I just went on a bit of a fly around, if I remember. I saw a big cavern, I thought it looked kind of cool, and I just started kind of looking around, flying around. Waste time. stone bricks, which I quite like. As you see, that's why we got the silk touch pickaxe, is to make sure I didn't waste any glass. And I started filling in the massive windows for the first floor. Well, at first, like I said, I never really did anything major, or I say major, I didn't do anything at all within 100 days for the first floor. It actually just kind of turned into a bit of a mob farm unintentionally. But I did initially have the idea to do the exact same thing as I did on the ground floor. So I would fill in the space with just a ridiculous amount of chests, but I did eventually decide against that. Firstly, it was because I couldn't be bothered. A bit of a theme, as I think you're probably realising, but I couldn't really be bothered to do that again. It was getting a bit tiresome cutting down all that wood. But also because I was thinking it could start causing lag, not necessarily on the server as a whole. Certainly for myself, a bit of like frame rate drop and stuff. I think a good thing is that, at least I think it's the case that only within like 32 blocks, or it might even be less than that, maybe like 25 blocks or something, chests don't render outside of that number. So I think, you know, if you've got a nice big base, certainly at one end, if I'm standing where my little cow pen is, then there will be pretty much none of the chests rendered at that distance, so that's pretty good. D92, as you've been seeing, I've been hollowing out a fair area underground. The reason for this is I wanted to earn a bit of money. I definitely need the stone for the flooring, as you can see, and the roofing. But I also wanted to sell things like granite and diorite and stuff like that, just to get a bit of money to expand my area even further. And in day 93, as you can see, I'm actually putting down that stone brick flooring. I was hollowing out the underside, basically, of where the beacon was, so that I could use the power-ups that it gives, I guess. Power-up, I'm not sure if that's the right term, but yeah, it just gives you extra mining speed and all the rest of it. We've recently had a meeting, my dubbing process for this video has been quite long, and so I started dubbing this video maybe about 3 or 4 weeks ago, maybe even more than that, maybe a solid month ago. And I'm now finally finishing it, and in that time, only recently we had a meeting to discuss season 4, and it got me thinking a little bit about what I wanted to do. I'm pretty sure I still want to stay on my own. I do like having my own little space and having my own project that I can just work at my own kind of pace. And I'm not sure quite how much time I'll be able to sink into physically playing season 4, but then I do think I want to build something big and cool like this again, and maybe I'd do it from the beginning rather than and that was to chop down all of the cactus and make a bit of a, again, non-automated cactus farm. And that's what I built that little island for. And the second one was to finish off, or I guess not really finish off, because I've been expanding kind of gradually throughout the 100 days, but that was to put up and finish off the huge stone wall or cobblestone wall that I wanted to around my area. So I did a bit more admin in day 96, so that included breeding up the cows, as you saw, and continuing with the copper blocks. At this point it was becoming a bit of a copper jungle, and I just went back and forth with the cows, and I liked the way that it was coming together. I set up another little cow pen because I saw some cows roaming around on the opposite side of my base, and I lured them in and started breeding them up. And then I decided that there was actually one extra thing that I just wanted to start that I would then be continuing into day 200. And as far as I remember, I got as far as the sort of outer structure of it, if I remember correctly. I always, especially in like hardcore series or hardcore worlds that I have, I always set up a bit of a mob farm in, from the perspective of, and in ASMRcraft it is maybe less necessary because there's so many people creating crazy farms that unless you're just trying to be totally self-sufficient, it's not really that important, but I quite like them. It's an easy bit of additional efficiency that you can add to the area because they just kind of jog along as you're in the area and they're loaded. So I decided to put one up. I decided that, as I usually do, is I would do it in a wood structure. So this was, as you can see there, that would be the sort of general outline for it, and I don't even think I really got to the end of it even in 200 days, but I got it finished off and it was working in 200 days, but I wanted it to look like a jungle tree, but so I was laying down the sort of flooring to the thing, and that's actually always one thing that I get wrong when I build this. You don't actually have to build this middle layer that I'm building now, because there doesn't need to be anything there. The mobs are going to be falling on or into the water that's along those wood beams that you can see, but I literally always forget when I make these things, so wasting a bit of wood here, but hey-ho. I suppose it might in some way make it look a bit better from the underneath, but my plan ultimately was to cover this all with jungle leaves anyway to make it like a jungle tree, but I don't think I ever actually got around to that in the end, so maybe a little bit redundant, but yeah, that's what I'm technically doing, a bunch of useless slab placement. And then of course going back and forth, chopping down jungle trees. And I thought in a way it was fitting that I finish the final couple of days chopping down more jungle wood, because well, that made up a significant portion of basically everything I did within these 100 days. I would be really interested to see what you think about the whole 100 days. Moving into day 99, it was more of the same, and the copper block placement and retrieval and cow breeding and all the rest of it. To be honest, I was quite happy to not finish on some sort of massively dramatic point. I was briefly tempted to do like some kind of further. I'm sure you'll get further. Now, if you've got to this point in the video and you're still watching, or you're still kind of using it to consider joining the server, I think it would be worth considering that the server is really dead at the moment. It's basically the end of season 3 for the most part. For 99% of players, the season has already finished. By all means, join the server, have a look around, see if you can find the area that I've built this place in, if you so wish. Be interested to see if you can find it. I don't think I ever actually really officially gave away the coordinates. And hopefully this has all been quite a fun thing for those of you who were playing along at the time and never knew that I was this anonymous Dr. Flaff. Funny enough, no one realised in the time I revealed it about 3 or 4 weeks ago during a live stream. And people weren't able to guess, unless they were just playing along. It was quite successful in that respect. If you're wondering why, come to the end of day 99, I was building the walls out of horrible dirt, because I didn't want the place to set on fire if it got struck by lightning. But anyway, day 100, here we are, finally. I've really enjoyed making this video. I really, really like making 100 days videos. They are nice little projects, and something I've been considering for some time is changing up how I make content on my channel, especially seeing as I will be not able to make regular, you know, 2 or 3 videos a week from now on. I think it'd be better if I do spend more time on quality rather than quantity. And I don't know, I think that could be a bit stronger for the medic community as well, focusing on that rather than just pumping out video after video. So I think I might do this from now on, is just focus on making really long, really detailed videos. Let me know what you think about that, of course. And as I said, anyway, finishing off 100 days, sort of as I vaguely began as well, by laying out this huge snaking cobblestone wall around my claimed area. I just like how these look, and from memory, hopefully I remember to put it in the recorded video, but the edited video was a sort of flyover of the area. I think we sneak into day 101, if I remember correctly. I will give you, if I don't, I'll do it when I do a little live outro, or live commentary outro. Just show you the area. I won't do it too in detail, because you guys know the area well after this huge series. But anyway, guys, thank you so much for watching, taking the time to enjoy 100 days in ASMRcraft. It's been a lot of fun. Yes, we are doing a